Please rise and salute the flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, this is the June 6th budget workshop. Mr. Martino, can you please call the roll, please?
Yes, Mr. Wolf. Mrs. Bites?
Here.
Mr. Kurtz?
Here.
Mr. Martino, here. Mr. Okus O'Neil?
Here.
Mr. Potts?
Here.
Mr. Rathkin?
Here.
Mr. Scott? Ms. Radowski?
Here.
Mr. Wolf?
Here. Okay. The goal for tonight, I believe, is to discuss these middle school staffing, the support staff, tenant agreement discussion. And then we'll discuss the final budget, develop it, and come up with a recommendation for a vote on Monday the 13th. So to start it off, let's start off with the middle school staffing position. Who's going to start that conversation?
I'll just say we discussed it in the curriculum instruction committee, and I'm going to discuss it here now. Perhaps, I know Mr. Early gave us a number of people before, and then the director jumped in, and maybe Mr. Early would be like, maybe the same information you made to see it out.
Yeah, I mean, the simple version of this is if you look at it the way our scheduling is, we're looking at our average class size in fifth grade is going to be around 25 students. And I'll skip to seventh grade also. Our average class size in seventh grade next year is going to be around 25 students. And our average class size in eighth grade is going to be around 25 students. Next year, if we do not eliminate a position in sixth grade, our average class size will be 22 students on average. And we'll be arranged there, guys. If we do eliminate a position, our average class size will be around 25, which is right along with what we're looking at fifth, sixth, seventh, and eighth grade. Again, there is a little bit of a range that you will see of, because you deal with leveling and things of that nature, you'll see about three students range, give or take, at all depends on student needs and what courses they're scheduled in. So that's kind of the facts of the situation itself. Jenny, if you'd like to add anything, feel free.
And when we discussed this the other day, I stated that I absolutely understand where you're coming from. It does put the class sizes on par with the other grades in the middle school. However, my only concerns are just that the sixth grade is the incoming group of students. They are more needy in some areas than my seventh and eighth graders. The transition is a big thing for them. They don't have some supports that my seventh and eighth grade do have. For example, in seventh and eighth grade, my students do get extra math support if they need it. They have an intervention. However, we don't have an additional person for that. We also lost an extra reading support a couple years ago. So there's not quite as much reading support to go around in the middle school as there used to be, although there's still the need. So I had just said that I would appreciate if, because the class that is coming behind the group of fifth graders that's coming up, because they are larger, so that position would need to come back to sixth grade. If there was the opportunity to keep it, that I could use it for interventions because it's needed, I would greatly appreciate it just to keep that person in the middle school, because my sixth grade staff is wonderful. I have 11 wonderful sixth grade teachers who work really well in the middle school, and they work as teams, and they've just been doing an excellent job this year with the change this year. So it would be wonderful if I could keep the person. Again, I understand if I cannot, but I wanted to at least express that I really could use that individual in the building. Eliminating the position does also change teaming again, which that changed last year because I will have one fewer person, so I will need to change the teams. I would likely reduce one team down to two from three, and depending on who the person is who ends up being moved, that could change more than one team. It might not just be a simple, this team just loses a person kind of thing. I might need to move some people around just because of what people are teaching currently. But that was really the focus of my plea, I should say, last week, was just that sixth grade does tend to be more needy because they're coming from elementary and it's a huge transition for them, and they do need some extra supports in math, which they aren't currently getting in sixth grade, and we are in need of some reading support as well. So it would be great if I could keep the person, but again, if you need to cut the person and then move them to keep class sizes at 25, I get it.
Mr. Kurtz, what was the recommendation from the CMAT committee?
There were some questions about the numbers as were presented. We did not issue a recommendation. We decided we were going to discuss it again. And then we were, when it came up with the full board meeting, and we decided to have this meeting instead. Mm-hmm. So there was no recommendation made.
Anybody have any thoughts?
Yes, naturally. I think our administrators need to understand that as part of the management team, that they've got a joint obligation of providing a quality education and managing the finances. Every position we keep that can or should be eliminated equates to roughly $100,000. $100,000 is more than a tenth of a mil of taxes to the 21,000 wonderful taxpayers of this district. I had a text from the assistant to the superintendent that I thought committed to eliminating this position. I believe I heard the superintendent say that position's gone. Now, all of a sudden, at the last minute, I'm hearing it would be wonderful to keep it.
May I just say that as a middle school principal, obviously the more adults I have in my building, the more teachers I have in my building, the better I think that my students do. I understand that, and that's why I said, whatever you guys decide,
you started
I can
out,
make it work.
Mr. Rexford, you started out by saying that these students would have 25 in a class if we cut the teacher. Mm-hmm. In fifth grade, they're policy limit is up to 26.
Mm-hmm.
So 25 is not extraordinary.
Right. Oh, no, I don't believe that it is at all. I'm just saying, as a middle school principal,
I
think I can do a better job with the person
kept,
I understand if that's the direction that the board wishes to go. That's all I'm saying.
Mrs. Rexford, I appreciate that you make sure the board knows the impact of our decisions. As it trickles down, I truly appreciate it. It's a tough decision, and I think it's important for us to know what how it's affecting the school and the students in particular.
And let's put it in context. It's not just 25 kids, because when middle school works, kids do go in and out of class, so that class size will range from, could be 22, could be 30, could be 28, could be 20. But so those classes aren't static because of the folks that go in and out. In fact, if you look at some of our math classes, the past couple of years, we've seen them up to 28, 29, 30 kids. And, her point was that the class after this is cut back up in size. And after that, it goes down again. So I think the thought process was that we wanted to keep a, shall we say, seasoned teacher in the house for a couple of years. That I would think most likely at that point we hope for a resignation, and then we could keep that teacher there, and then where the retirement then would take care of that. The 2 years we have to reduce, retirement might take that into account then. So
I understood her point.
Yeah.
But by your own logic, if we drop it to 22, then with this range you're talking about, we'd have some classes with 17 or 18 in it.
Correct. I'm not disputing that. The fact, absolutely, next year's sixth grade class will be on the later side. I'm not questioning that.
my point is this board is already leaning toward raising taxes. Every position you add raises taxes even more.
And so what is the position that would be cut? So not asking for a name, but once we go through all the seniority rights, what's the salary of that person that could be cut?
We're at, what, about 100?
What's that?
The salary range of the person, it was, I'm sorry, it was 69? 69,000 with benefits.
With or without?
With.
So it's only about 70,000 with benefits.
Yeah, I thought there was a discussion about another option.
There's one other option that requires bumping and everything else, but we're looking also at BEC through retirements. There were savings there also.
I think the other option involved the gym teacher.
Gym teacher. That was discussed in CNI. I wasn't in the CNI meeting. I'm sorry.
I had made a proposal just to, let's say, keep the sixth grade at 11 teachers. I had worked out a scenario where I could, since I knew there was a retirement in PE in the elementary, where I could give up one of my PE teachers in order if I would be able to save the sixth grade position, but it would reduce the amount of PE that my students had. So it certainly wasn't ideal. I was just looking at a way to keep a position in the district, because then I would be filling a need that you had, as opposed to somebody losing their job down the line. But
this is where the confusion came up in the committee, as to what positions were included in the budget and which positions were not.
I'm not recommending it, because I don't want to cut the PE program that we have currently. It was just a way to say, you know, if you would be willing, maybe this is something that I could offer. But again, it cuts PE that the students have.
I believe I asked this question to CNI, but I think it was an issue for the whole board to hear. If we were to reduce that PE position, even outside of the discussion now, even if that position is in the budget, that would result in more students having more class instruction time, if you will, right?
Well, that would, of course, be the hope. But it would just depend on whether or not it would be able to work out. My hope was to be able to figure out how to get more math time in the day by doing that. But again, until I know exactly what I'm working with and the numbers I'm working with, I don't want to commit to that 100%. And I certainly don't want to make it seem like I don't need the PE position, and that was kind of where that's where I felt the conversation had started to go in the curriculum and instruction meeting, which is why I kind of backed off on it, because I don't want it to be at all that the middle school doesn't need the PE position and the kids don't need 2 days of PE a cycle, because of course kids need physical education, and of course they need to get outside, and they don't get outside enough, and they aren't physically active enough, because a lot of kids are playing video games and staying inside the house. So I didn't want it to be that. I was just looking at a way of saying, hey, if you'd be willing to consider this, maybe this is something that we could do. But again, that was just an option that I put out there.
Let the record show that Mr. Scott has joined the meeting at 6:14.
Question. How far off dollar wise are we right now that we're looking to reduce? Because that's still, for me, is still a question. Are we looking at just straight dollars, or are we really looking at positions? Because if we can get the savings through non-position reductions, through retirements, we have a number of retirements that are occurring. Can we achieve our goal that way?
Depends on who on the board you talk to.
Well, I'm talking to everyone right now.
I asked Mr. Smalls to maybe bring that to light before the meeting, if you could just share some input on what we're proposing, what we have budget preparation 10 in a long day.
So if we can have Mr. Smart explore this a little bit, and I discuss briefly, and numbers might not be that far apart.
Because I ask, because we have some senior people retiring.
Yeah, three in this budget.
Right, who are at the top of the pay scale, and even replacing them, they're coming in almost really half of what they cost. I'm sorry?
Should be a net.
Yeah, so if our net is, you know, $150,000 in savings just to retirement and still replacing them, I think that's a win. I'm just not sure where we are, because I remember we talked about some positions and in the budget, not in the budget. We talked about it before the contracted services agreement was done. So now it's been updated. You know, how far off are we?
With all positions back in the budget except for the middle school position, with the savings from outsourcing contracted service as approved by the board, looks like we're using about $1.6 million in fund balance. With the ending, we're projecting your ending this year approximately 3.8, and we'll be reducing that to 1.3. So 1.5 million is really good. Yeah.
One and a half million.
Your fund balance is, your ending fund balance, moving from the 15-16 year to the end of the 16-17 year, is about $1.5 million fund balance. And that does reflect any impact that would be felt in the 16-17
year from your bank qualified savings, your proposed savings on debt service will be kicking in with the 17-18
year on the swap issue.
So with the two retirements, the physical education teacher and the counselor, both at the higher end of the pay scale, keeping those positions, bringing someone in roughly 70,000 net, that's about half almost. So we save 100. I mean, we're not going to get there with $1.5 million.
Nothing regarding the gym teacher. I don't have any information.
Right. That's new.
And
the counselor.
The counselor is still in the total, so you have a savings of the difference between the 93 and the start set. Have a $40,000 salary savings if you hire the start step against the $94,000 position.
Okay.
Mrs. Small, just for clarification, does the fund balance change from 3.8 million to 2.3 million that you just mentioned include rehiring for the three retired positions? So that.
When you say three retirement positions.
I didn't say three. I know there's two. We have the physical ed teacher and the counselor. Who else is retired?
Nothing is reflected regarding this budget, or physical ed teacher.
Okay.
The guidance counselor dollars are still in place.
That's part of it. Okay. So
still in the total, so there would be a reduction. There would be a savings. These higher start stuff. $40,000
When you say three retirements, do you mean the ones where we're talking that we could lose three teachers due to class sizes, but now we're not?
They're back in. The elementary for the last budget meeting, I believe it was a budget meeting discussion, they're all back in.
Okay. But with the council's not. The retirement of the counselor is not included in this.
Still in there, just as if she wasn't retiring. But to take that out and go back in the start step, you're going to have approximately 40,000
students. Okay, so let me ask Rob. Am I missing anyone? We have a counselor and a gym teacher.
You got a gym teacher, and a guidance counselor, and you have a special ed teacher.
Special ed, okay.
but the guidance counselor, that's going to be, is that a needed position over at EC? So we need to replace that person.
But they won't be, and what everyone's saying, they're not going to be at the same high salary.
No, I understand there's to be a difference between the salary of the person retiring and the person coming in.
And the same is true of the gym teacher, assuming that we replace high end of the pay scale versus
the low.
Presumably lower.
Yes.
So it's possible that the savings from the two, because we're hiring at a lower pay scale, could pay the salary, the middle school salary that we're discussing. I mean, if we chose to allocate it that way, we could describe it as covering that.
Yeah, and we would still have a net savings.
Right. Okay, thank you.
I was just trying to get to the amount that, is there an amount we need to get to?
Right.
This is Retro. Do you have a question for you? You know, I know from past years, you know, we've heard how well the middle school works with a teaming environment, you know, how their achievement is reflective of that. How would a reduction of one individual, how would that affect it either way? What would be the difference to the students?
Well, I just think overall, like I said, in sixth grade, it is a rough transition for them. And this year with a class size that was supposed to be about 25, there were some classes that ended up being 29. I believe I had at least one on each team. Obviously, that's not ideal. You have that many students, especially when it's a math class, and I think two of them were mainly because I had that many students who were recommended for the accelerated math class, and I didn't have anywhere else to go with them, so they had to all be in one class. With the Common Core being implemented, it has been a challenge to meet all of the standards as they are. Math in particular is the biggest area. That's the area that the middle school struggled with the most with last year's PSSA. And I would guess that probably this year that will be reflective also, although I do anticipate that the scores will go up given that we've had a year under our belts with it. But it does take a lot more time, a lot more focus, a lot more work with the kids outside of just those 43 minutes that they have math class every day. So if I have 10 teachers instead of 11, that's one fewer teacher that can, you know, work with the kids eighth period or during an IHT or before school, after school, those kinds of things. So I can't ever say that reducing the number of teachers I have will make a positive impact on them. It's hard to predict if it would have a negative impact. Obviously, if I were able to keep the teacher and use them to help remediate in some of those areas that are needed because of previous cuts, I would think that would be obviously helpful.
So you would use this person to augment that math program for those that are struggling? Is that what you...
Yeah, I mean, ideally that's what I'd like to do because I feel that that's the area that we need the most support in the middle school. And right now we only have one person who does that. We have two teachers who work with students who are struggling in reading, but we only have one for math. So she works only with seventh and eighth grade teachers, but she just doesn't have enough time in her day. So it would be great if I could use that because, again, the 10 teachers that I would then have in sixth grade, the average of the class size would be about what they are this year, which is doable. Again, there were a couple that were a little larger than I would have liked, but I don't know what the numbers look like coming from fifth grade this year either. But yes, if I could use that for that would be wonderful to be able to have that as an intervention. However, I am going to bring this up just because I'm sure some of you were thinking of it, though. If I do use that person in that capacity for next year, the following year, the idea would be that person would go back into sixth grade because the class size would go up. So I would have to find something to do with those kids that need that extra help. So I would hope that that person would be able to catch up all the kids who are behind and I won't need it. But I don't want to promise that I'm not going to come to you then next year and be like, wow, that position was so helpful, can we keep it? So I just want to throw that out there just because, you know, I don't want to come back to you next year if you allow me to keep it and have you go, well, you said that you weren't going to need it. And
1 year at a time.
So, yeah. But, I mean, if I could have 1 year to bring up the test scores and to get some of that remediation in so some of the kids can get back to the level where they should be, that would be wonderful. I mean, it's better than having no years of it, so.
Thank you. Any other discussion on it? Any thoughts? So what was the net? The net is about 40? Is that what I heard?
I'm not sure. I was not sure.
What's the back of the napkin number? About 40 net?
Mr. Wolf, the 40 is just... Right, it's just the counseling, right? Not the gym.
Right. I have no right. Ever worked anything.
I'm not saying that's going to happen. I'm simply saying if, in fact, that turns out to be the case, there would be additional savings for the gym teacher as well.
There's also on the elementary side, with the reconfiguration, a cost of about $20,000. Am I correct, Dean? Yeah, about $20,000. Because of the encore time needed with the shift from, with Amity losing the kindergarten, we now have a larger group that's going to be taking encore classes. So that time needs to be extended about, what's the time? 20 minutes. 40 minutes. And that's the total cost that we calculated so far to be about $20,000.
Yeah, we've replaced kindergarten, which only had phys ed, with third grade coming in, which gets all on course. So that's why the increase in 40 minutes of instruction time.
What's everybody's thought on it?
I, for one, don't want to cut it. I don't think it's worth it. I think it's going to wash out. And I hate to upset the delicate balance that we have up there. I think too many good things are happening at the middle school. And I think it's too small amount of money to really take. I think the impact would be great.
I agree with Mrs. Weiss.
Sure. Put it to a straw vote, just so we understand what we're doing. What decisions we're making? Mr. Martino?
All in favor say aye. All in favor of not cutting it? Is that what we're doing?
Not right. Cutting it.
All in favor of not cutting it say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? No.
No, whatever.
Seven,
I don't know what two fingers meant. What?
I'm saying no. We should reduce it.
So your straw vote is okay. 7-2 and not cut.
Okay. Now, we want to have a continuing conversation with the physical education teacher?
I would like to meet again with the admins at the work through scheduling, because when we're putting scheduling together, that's when these things are coming up. So I know the middle school is looking at the phys ed, but when we sit down and really do the schedules like we did with elementary, we're discovering things time-wise. So can we have another week to look at scheduling? Because,
well, the idea is to make a recommendation for the 13th for a budget.
Then.
And the only reason that is there's at least two of us won't be able to make it here on the end of the month. I mean, if it is, I'll drive the hour and a half back to be here. And I think Mr. Rathgeb also said he can conference in. But
well, you can go ahead. Well, this is a working session, right?
It's a working session.
Right.
We can talk about it.
Yeah. Let's go ahead. Talk.
We're trying to. Not rehire the gym teacher, is that the goal?
Or, I'm just, yeah, you know, since it was brought up, I'm...
It was brought up as an alternative to not losing the position. And I think it was brought up not kind of vetting everything through. So, over the last...
Is this one of the part-time gym teachers? Is this that was left or retired?
Well, this is the middle school position.
The middle school one.
Right, we're still in the middle school.
I thought the retirement was in the elementary school one, and now I'm more confused.
No, we're talking about the same type of position, just different location. We're talking about a reduction of an employee position, and we have a middle school, we have an elementary phys ed person retiring, and we have...
So my question was...
That person was a full-time...
Was it a two-pronged approach to try and do we need to replace that person, or was the idea moving the middle school to that spot?
The middle school person was going to go into the retiree spot. Am I correct?
That was the thought process here.
Right.
The things that will happen, and I'll let Jenny chime in on this, one of the things that will happen, we'll be cutting curriculum, which you need to assess something you have to be aware of. So you will be cutting curriculum.
Excuse me, is that phys ed curriculum?
Phys ed curriculum.
Just phys ed. Not that I'm making a value judgment.
Yeah, it's phys ed curriculum, just so we're clear on that. So that would be one of the repercussions of that. As to the scheduling of that, I'm going to have to refer this to Rex Schroeder as to the scheduling.
So I'll go back to my original question. The elementary retirement, was that a part-time? Full-time.
Can somebody, this is a question, I guess, for any administrator. When I was in middle school and high school, not as much elementary school, but would it be fair to characterize the gym teacher position as being more of a supervisory role, like you set the teams, and then you're largely there to make sure that nothing goes wrong? Is that an accurate description of the role of gym teacher in middle school and high school?
I would say no.
Okay. Can you give an overview as to what the middle school gym teacher does?
Well, on a general day, they, first of all, obviously have to make sure that the students are safe and doing all the right things in the locker room. They then are teaching different things. So for instance, if it's the volleyball unit, they are teaching how to serve, how to spike the ball, how to rotate through a game, how to do basically all of those things, and then the students will practice that, and then they'll monitor it, and then they will give feedback to the students and have them try different things. So the only time I would say that you might be partially correct is when they've learned all of those things, then they might be playing a game, so then the teachers are rotating through, still giving the kids feedback on what they're doing, but the ultimate goal is that they're able to play the game, kind of like in social studies class when all the way through they're teaching the unit, and then when they get to the end, there's a final assessment. It's kind of the same thing, because you could argue that they're just watching them give the final, like take the test at the end. So it's the same kind of thing, except that they're watching them play the game or do whatever it is that they've learned up to that point.
I understand where you're coming from. Maybe it's changed. It could have changed since I was in school. But even the instruction of, say, volleyball, it wasn't a continuous process. It was, here's how you serve, here's how you bump, here's how you spike. And it was maybe 20 minutes that first day that lesson was happening. And the rest of the committee was a few weeks of the volleyball unit. That was just spent students practicing the skills they learned in that first half of class.
Well, I can say that.
Oh, sorry. No, I was going to say, I don't know. Maybe that's what you're saying. Maybe it's what I'm saying. I'm not sure, really. Maybe it's in between. But anyway, if you had a response.
Well, no, I was just going to say that I am in and out of those classes quite a bit because there are student concerns that happen. Like, if I find out that a student maybe is giving a teacher a hard time, I might stop into that class quite a bit just to make sure that everything's fine. And that's a class that I happen to like when I do my rounds walking into. So I've seen them quite a bit doing instruction of different things. And usually they'll break it down by day. So it's not, here's how to do all these things in one day, now do it. It's more of a, today we're going to learn how to
I'm sorry, I don't mean to turn this into a symposium.
That's okay.
Gym class. No, I'm remembering now the rest of the board is here too, and they have questions. My main point, though, before getting into that, I was going to ask, what is the class size right now in the middle school for gym class? For every one gym teacher?
Well, it ranges, and it ranges because right now we have three gym teachers. One of them teaches health to our eighth grade. So while that teacher is teaching health, obviously there are then two teachers to have the rest of the eighth grade. So if, for example, you're saying we have 300 students, if a third of them are having health class at one time, then the remainder of them could be having gym. So it ranges anywhere from about 25, which is the average class size, to a lot lower. I would say there are some classes that meet when band is meeting, for example, because our band is 70, 80 students at a time. So obviously when those students are pulled and are in band, there's fewer students that are left to take gym class. So on the days that band meets, there might be 17 students in a gym class. So per teacher though. So yeah, we're talking about 35 students basically in a class.
So you're telling me that we could have lower gym classes, lower size gym classes than we do math classes?
Yes.
Okay.
But well, again, that's mainly because of things that are going on at other times. It doesn't work the same as when there's a core, like, and not to go into a whole lot of detail, but when students are in their core classes and they're on a team, if there are five teachers on that team, the 150 students are divided up among those teachers because they only have core classes. When they're out for encore, if 80 of those kids are having band at that time, now there's only however many that's left, 40 or 50 kids that are able to be in the rest of the encore. So yes, but on other days,
yeah,
the gym classes are much bigger.
My question, and I'll end with this because again, I'm taking up a lot of time here. If we're able to get by when that one gym teacher is out teaching health, we're able to get by with two gym teachers with about 25 students, and it works then, I don't know, I mean, my perspective would be it should work.
Well, and that was my thinking. The biggest problem runs into when my eighth grade needs to have help, because then you would only have one teacher available to teach PE, which is why then I would have to cut PE in half.
Would there be a way to schedule that? So you mentioned when the days you have band, that you only have 17 students. Could you set your schedule up in a way that at those times, that's when the teacher would be leaving, so those classes wouldn't be 50 students, instead they'd be, I don't know, 40-something.
What do you mean the teacher leaving?
You mentioned for health classes, you'd have, instead of having your three teachers, mm-hmm, you have two.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm saying, well, what if you set up your health schedule? I mean, I guess you have the issue then of the band.
Well, the problem is that every single child in the middle school in eighth grade has to take health. So it's not as easy as not everybody has to take band or not everybody has to have art. Every single kid in the middle school in eighth grade has to take health. So if there's, again, if there's 300 students in the eighth grade, among six different, they only have the ability to have so many health classes because they need twice a cycle. So, it's not as easy to cut back on that.
Since this is an idea session, right? So do we still have any of the reduced part-timers in PE that are in the elementary school?
The part-timers, no.
That's strictly the art and or down there.
You're talking the phys ed part-timers, no, yeah, not available to help us out in that situation. Plus,
are there still part-time
kids? In phys ed, no.
No.
In art and some of the
art. I think maybe you could bring one back full time and have them go over and we'll get to the.
Okay. Well, what's everybody's thought on it?
Then Jenny, so when if we did cut that person, and like you said, you have to find classroom time for that, those folks to go. So what would it be? I mean,
well, initially, I had remembered that at a middle school principal meeting that I had been to, that there's a school, and I didn't remember which school it was, that they actually reduced their PE to one day a cycle, and then when the student is not in PE, they go back to their math class for one period. So instead of having six periods of math over...
Right, but do we actually have teachers to do this?
Well, it would be the math teacher's duty. So instead of the math teacher having, for example, a lunch duty or an IHT or ISS duty or something like that, the duty that they would have would be to teach one additional period of each one of their math classes. Now, again, that assumes that all of those kids that are in the math class can go back to math class that same period every day, which I spoke to the IU about it to see if that is something that is relatively easy to do with our e-school system, and he said yes, but I would need the approval, obviously, to cut PE, because I'd be cutting it in half for all students, and then obviously would have to work out based on the students and their needs during the encore time. So do I think I can do it? I do. And I was hoping to try it even if this didn't happen. But again, my biggest concern just with this is that, yes, my students are going to have 50% less PE than they have right now.
And I mean, you know, probably the kids that would be affected most are the ones that, I mean, you know, nowadays the athletes, they go to so many clubs and professional, they pay, or you know, baseball, basketball, football, all that. So those kids who are already in athletics, it's probably not going to hurt them. It's the ones that are not. But, you know, I mean, I do have to say, I mean, I'm also on the side of, you know, if we got to cut something, then maybe he's the one to cut.
I have, again, I don't know why I'm getting some ideas about this gym in here, but the first may be a little bit more out of the box, if you will. Would it be possible to kind of intertwine or interweave into the general curriculum some of that physical education, at least the education of these things, maybe not going outside and running a mile per se, but maybe you can have maybe little blocks in the, maybe, I don't know, do some exercises during the school day, maybe after morning announcements, do jumping jacks, I don't know, just ideas how you can maybe get kids moving throughout the school day, which may be beneficial, I mean, even if gym stays the way it is. The other point I have on gym class, if we were to reduce it to one day per cycle, maybe there can be a reevaluation of the PE curriculum, and I don't remember, I know when I was in high school and syllabus, it had a list of maybe 25, 30 things we cover, and you can tell looking at it, you can, there are certain skills you can learn in PE that may last, that might last a lifetime, like knowing how to play volleyball, I mean, you do that throughout your life, but maybe, I don't know, doing the rock wall in gym for 2 weeks, maybe that isn't quite up there. So there could be some realignment potential there in terms of what the middle school PE curriculum looks like.
And well, and obviously there would have to be because they have half of what.
But what I'm saying is maybe,
we have
maybe,
to have it.
Sure, but I'm saying maybe if we look at it again from that, maybe take a blank page and we can come up with a even stronger PE program, even with fewer time or less time rather.
Okay. Decision time. Who, by show of hands, who's in favor of cutting a middle school teacher from PE? From
they would cut.
I probably go that route.
And what's the saving? And they would go to work. They would go to elementary school. So
yes.
In essence, we're cutting to.
We're not cutting to
transfer. I mean.
Correct. Right, we're
right,
not
I mean,
rehiring an elementary teacher.
You're reassigning them to.
We're reassigning them to middle school.
You're still cutting a position.
Net.
Yeah.
You're losing.
But we're not cutting a person, I guess.
Yes.
You're losing a person through retirement.
It'll be cut through attrition, so nobody would lose their job.
Well, again, who was in favor of removing that position?
Well, I just want to make sure I understand.
Yeah, there's still some.
We're still just trying to make sure.
Okay.
Yes.
So instead of hiring a new person, it would be that person would not lose their job. They're just going to go and replace.
Mrs. Bites asked what the savings would be.
I would need to know. I know the salary of the retiring gym teacher, but.
What is that?
It would be a new hire.
What would it be?
A new hire.
So we're talking about $45,000.
We're talking about $40,000.
Well, if you hire him at the lowest,
right.
That
starts that.
But I thought you weren't hiring. I thought you were transferring somebody.
But in essence, we would.
Yeah, the whole thing is saved, though. So what? I mean.
So whatever the retiring person makes is what you would save. Yes.
It's sort of a range, really, because you can hire someone at the low end or the high end. So we're saving what that person technically is retiring with, but we're saving the range, so it's roughly...
So you're simply transferring one gym teacher from one building to another.
Yes.
Salary remains intact because they're full, they're not Concord. So the savings would be the retiring, which is $87,000.
Which is how much?
$87,000.
Right, but if we're replacing them, it would cost us 50.
The savings is the cost of the person that you don't hire instead, not the retiring salary.
Right.
Right?
Well, that would be the difference between the retiring person's salary and a new person's salary. So 38, 40.
For an investment of $40,000.
Back to 40 again.
You're saving what you're not hiring.
You're getting a training.
Yes.
Correct.
It's not the salary of the person.
Right, but it's not clear in my mind whether we're only evaluating the transfer, the savings generated from a simple transfer versus hiring as well. I don't know how to describe what I'm saying correctly, but...
You're saving the difference between the retiree salary and the new person's salary.
I understand that.
To keep both programs in place will cost us $40,000 more.
No.
Yeah, that's...
Right? Yes.
Whatever the...
So we're talking about $40,000 investment to keep everything the way it is in both schools. Right?
I mean, the 40,000 that she, that Mrs. Bites is mentioning is the cost of a new gym teacher, right? Right, so I'm just...
Closer to 50.
Right, so...
With benefits, 50.
Yes.
No, 50 salary, plus benefits.
Plus benefits.
The start step is closer to 50.
Can anybody go, could the new person go part-time at BBC?
No.
No? No. It's all or nothing.
Can you do a part-time at the middle school to keep the second day?
What we would have to look at is scheduling at BEC, and would there be time available to go to the middle school?
Going off what Ms. Wadowski just said, so currently it's 2 days, 2 meetings per cycle at the middle school for gym. Would it be possible to do 1.5 meetings per cycle? So you have for every 2 weeks, 3 gym classes. I mean, we had something similar. When I was there, we had to do that to schedule the
We are down 100, and tell me if I'm wrong, Dane, 120 students at BEC?
All the grades?
Right.
Approximately.
120. So that's 120 less students for gym at BEC. So there should be some time available scheduling-wise that teacher could go over to the middle school. No? Am I wrong?
Sorry, I don't mean to correct you, boss.
Okay, correct me.
Yeah,
I don't mind.
That phys ed teacher is teaching from 8:50 until 2:55. The other problem you're going to run into... The Noxie handbook,
Forgot.
You're a 5-day cycle at the elementary level, you're a 6-day cycle at a secondary school.
I forgot they covered Monocacy. I forgot about Monocacy. Sorry. Yeah.
So what's the recap on this whole discussion?
Reduction of the position at the middle school, transferring that person to Birdsboro to cover Monocacy also. And...
Which would net $40,000 for the difference between the retiring person's salary and the person you would hire to replace that person that retired.
Yes.
I think he's saying 50 though. The net savings is 50, right?
No, the salary would be
50. Well, salary and benefits, correct.
To replace the retiring teacher would be 50.
You'd have a $40,000 salary savings between current salary and start step, salary only.
As one of Connor's former phys ed teachers, it kind of pains me to hear what he's talking about as far as kind of phys ed.
Well,
I guess I'm partly responsible for
that. I completely forgot you were one of the phys ed
teachers. I just want to throw out there, we're talking about cutting this back at a moment when childhood obesity is running rampant. So I'm throwing that out there. I'm certainly not going to tell Mrs. Rexroth about one of her fine schools. She does a terrific job here. So, as a phys ed guy, that kind of rubs me the wrong way when we're talking about cutting that position. Just putting that out there. Well, that's the situation with today's meeting.
Well, you want to arrive at a decision? Is everybody comfortable with?
Well, I'm very comfortable with if we could redirect it to math.
Yeah.
If that could happen.
Instead of a gym class, we'll have an extra math class.
Correct.
Because you have to put them somewhere. You can't just.
Since we're having to contest this issue, who's asked?
Sorry. I thought we were past the math issue, so. I'm not saying
you have every right to take it back, even if we are. I just thought we were past that. So that the reason I was perplexed is I thought we moved past the one issue. Yeah. Now we were just simply evaluating the position.
Still same one.
Because you're changing out the
regular
position.
I'm
not
changing out a retired person for a new person.
Yes.
So we'll call it $40,000 if you do nothing. Just replace the retired person.
Right.
If you cut the position, you save, 87.
Right. Right.
So the difference is
30,
50,000, 40,000, whatever, something like that.
Keep the stability of the system in place.
Because the point is you can still save $40,000 just because the person's retiring.
Right.
And keep Jim.
All right. Just so we can make a decision on his. Who is in favor of retaining the position? Raise your hand. 5-4.
While we're going to retain it, this is an idea session. Would there be any way to work Matt Beams into gym class? No, really. I mean, for experts,
what?
How many have a group over here? They do 15 jumping jacks. A group over here, they do 24. Add them up, divide them.
In Mandarin Chinese, we bring it out.
Look at that. I mean, how Spanish one day, count in French another day, any way we can,
We can remove all the desks and just have them run in place throughout the whole day.
We can be creative.
The 5-4 goal was 5, which way?
To keep as is.
I also would just like to say to the board, it's going to sound like I'm saying it to Mr. Kurtz, but I'm not. It's my understanding that the types of concerns that are being discussed that are not directly related to the budget should probably be tabled and discussed at curriculum. But I think the purpose of this discussion is to discuss the budget impacts of the staffing and educational arrangements that is now.
I know that's not directed at me, but it should have been. I've been getting off topic, so I'll try to stay on topic.
Let's go.
Tamara. No, take mine,
because
I won't talk.
Sorry. I just would like, I did vote to retain the position, and I think, especially with a lot of I'm not just the obesity, but I think a lot of behavioral issues today, activity's helpful, but I would request that we could maybe look at it and see if you can do that with a part-time position, because if you're saying that you could almost get away with two, except for when there's help, maybe we wouldn't have to hire a full-time person for that at the middle school. So I'm just throwing that out as a possibility.
Did you just vote to transfer the person to Birdsboro and keep the position? Okay, you just
we're keeping everything. We're replacing.
We are replacing
the retiree.
The retiree. But I guess what I'm saying is, could you replace the retiree with a transfer from the middle school with a full time and hire a part time person for the middle school?
To continue to evaluate it.
So you're saving some money. That's what I'm asking, I guess, is because I think it's important to have the two gym cycle days. But what I kind of heard is that we might, if we didn't have help, we could do that with two people. And then we talked about, so maybe you can hire a part-time person to either teach health or to teach gym.
Three-quarter time.
if you can...
Because enrollment's going down.
Send a full-time person to Birdsboro. I'm not
right.
saying get rid of the position altogether. I'm saying, do we need to really hire another full-time person for middle school, or could you transfer that full-time person to Birdsboro and hire a part-time middle school?
Right.
Or however
right.
you want
just
to do it.
Like,
instead of having two full-time, you can do one and a half. That's all.
I agree.
Thank you. That was yours. And I don't know.
So if I understand, so there was a vote not to reduce the teacher.
Right. We're just replacing him.
And to replace him.
Replace
no,
him with a
I'm
new
sorry.
Person.
Okay.
Replace the retired,
teacher.
And replace the retired teacher at Birdsboro. Keep
well,
the position.
Then maybe I guess what I should do is change my vote to reduce the position. And then can we look at hiring a part-time teacher for high middle school?
We could do that seasonally based on when health is. I mean, we could reach out to the university. I've done this before, bring someone in who's certified or do something seasonally. We can do that. You know, but I'm just trying to get clarity on. Okay.
Right. I guess what I'm saying is I don't want to cut the middle
you
school
the
gym class. I don't want to cut the program.
Okay.
Less about
but
the position
my question
more
is,
about the program.
Do we
yeah.
really need to hire full-time and have the
to
full-time
run the same program.
Right. That's all. So if I need to change my vote to get rid of the position and then so, say, hey, maybe we should look at hiring a part-time health teacher or gym teacher
okay.
or whatever for the middle school, then that's what I'll do.
Or can the board just direct
but I don't want to lose the extra gym class at the middle school necessarily.
Okay.
Well, it seems like you have an idea for that.
Right. It, depending on when the health season is, we could put something in place to supplement instruction for that time. So,
right. I don't care
okay.
how you do
okay.
it. But I'm just saying,
right.
do we really need two full-time positions, one at Birdsboro and one at Birdsboro? That's all. Thanks.
Now I have a question. What instructions are we giving Mr. Small regarding the budget?
For the staffing?
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, he needs to finalize the budget, and we just said we may do this and we may do that.
Well, we decided to keep the, we're going to replace the PE teacher with a new hire. And we're not removing the teaching position from the middle school. Those are the two decisions we made.
Right now you've got elementary counselor's position that's going to retire, that salary is going to go away, but you're going to fill the position with a lesser salary. You've got a gym teacher at a higher salary, going to retire, that salary will go away, but you're going to replace with a lesser salary. And you're not going to eliminate the middle school.
Right, so if I recall, the delta between those two positions was about 40,000 roughly, so 80,000 back to the general fund. Roughly, back to the napkin number.
That's my notes so far.
Except the last discussion was about hiring a part-time person.
Well, I was saying, you're going to have to figure that out before you hire, I think, if you can do it. Because then you would transfer your full-time person to Birdsboro.
Yeah.
And
so,
we're going to have to figure
so
it out.
So we're authorizing
we
a full-time
the
person right now.
Just leave
and
the spaceholder in the placeholder in the budget for the full amount.
Right.
Right.
Let's not...
But if we
back.
Can,
yes.
But if it can work,
while we direct
yeah.
administration
yeah.
to try and find out
it's yeah. not going to be a huge
more efficient
that.
Ways to
right.
do it.
It's going
to
be 20 grand.
Just
power.
Leave the placeholder at 58.
Mm-hmm.
But it's still, if it's something we can save.
Mm-hmm. Okay. All right. Now, the final budget development and recommendation. Like I said, if we can, I know we're not going to come to a unanimous agreement, obviously.
We might skip that.
Support staff.
I'm sorry. Support staff. Mr. Rathke, do you want to provide an update? Are you prepared? Sorry to throw you out there.
That's okay. I believe the full board's aware of what the tentative agreement was for our secretaries, aides, van drivers.
IT.
They did vote to ratify the TA on their side, the union side, last week. So the ball's in our court if we want to ratify the tentative agreement. Last week, I also did Mr. Small provided budget analysis, what he had budgeted for that group versus what the TA will cost the district, so that could go out. Any questions?
be voting on it after.
We'll be voting on it on Monday, next Monday.
I don't have any questions, but I have a lot of comments.
I'd be disappointed if you didn't.
Last summer, I thought we had a tentative agreement for 0% raise the first year and 2% the second year. And the union voted that down. And every time the negotiating team met with the union wanted more. To the point where this tentative agreement from 0 and 2% became 0 the first year, but a $500 signing bonus the second year, plus a 3% raise the second year, plus 2% the third year, plus an additional holiday, plus an additional vacation week, plus longevity increases, which comes out in the first year at least to much more than 5%. So even dividing the 5-some percent by 2 for the 2 years, you didn't wind up with 0 and 2%. We wound up with closer to 3% a year for the first 2 years. I mean, the $500 bonus alone cost $47,000. Also, at our last session, it became apparent that the vacation clause of the contract is screwed up. And our negotiating attorney said, well, we know this is screwed up. After this is all signed, we'll come back and revisit this. After it's signed, we're not revisiting anything. So my question is, are we really going to spend this much money? Are we really going to sign a contract and then try to revisit a clause later? And I think this is showing, seriously, I hope nobody's offended, but I'll say it anyway, this is showing board weakness. Because Mr. Rathgeb and I met with another group last week that automatically wanted a 5% raise because this group's getting a 5% raise. So, who's next? I've heard the administrators want to reopen their contract for more money. You know, we can't just keep doing this. I mean, at some point, when are we going to say, excuse me, we think you're adequately compensated, our taxes are already too high, and we're not going to raise taxes again to be giving people more raises. So we went from 0 and 2 to 0 plus 500 plus 3 plus 2 plus a holiday plus a vacation, and knowing the vacation clause is screwed up.
Just to remind everybody, the original agreement included a guarantee for no outsourcing. We outsourced 35 employees from Wisco. So that was part of the reason that those raises were annulled. That's that first agreement, which we never ever got anywhere. So
the vacation that you're referring to was for folks who worked here for 15 years. It wasn't for everybody.
Okay.
Okay. Right? And then the bonus, the $500 bonus, where are you getting the $47,000?
94 employees times 47, am I correct?
Well, that's a separate agreement, right? That's part of the impact bargaining?
No.
It's in the spreadsheet, signing the 47.
No, the $500 is part of this agreement. It has nothing to do with the impact bargaining.
Well, if we took the outsourcing of those folks, there's still 97 employees left in that group that are getting
94.
And then the salary increase, you said the TA was 0 and 2, right, which they declined, correct?
Yes.
So I guess your feeling is we should have just stuck with the 0 and 2 and said that's it.
Yes.
Mr. Rathke, why does your spreadsheet not show the total cost of the TA over 3 years? Did I get cut off or something? The bottom of the spreadsheet?
If you look on the tab 3, I believe. In the first half or the
tab 3, budgeted increases. I'm on the TA summary. There's a line for a total cost of TA over 3 years with a blank. Online. Is it just the way mine's reading or something?
I'm not sure. I pulled up, you know, everything was up.
if you're on the tab that says budgeted increases, you go to, looks like L42.
Any more discussion? If I recall the, I can't pull it up on my phone. If I recall the, that third tab was the net versus budgeted. It's like 14 something.
I included that in the email. The third tab has the total cost. The first tab backwards. The first tab has the total annual cost for the 2 years. And then if you look at the bottom line, the savings from the health care increases. So if you add the two H and J 32, subtract out H and J 34, that would be the total cost. And then what was budgeted is that third tab, that L 42 was the total that just got budgeted in his 5-year plan. So that's the total amount budgeted, and the costs are actually the first half. So my apologies.
Now, what was the what's the easy explanation for the vacation that's quote unquote screwed up as far as the contract? What's
that's a whole other issue. Apparently the way it works right now, maybe Mr. Small can correct me, but support staff accrues vacation in the current year to be paid out into the next year. Instead of the year they're working it.
Which is what we changed in the Act 93 agreement.
Correct, but I don't think that was brought to our attention until Thursday.
Correct.
When we negotiate. I guess you can go back and try to
change it. Yeah, I would say that that's, for continuity, I think it should be the same.
What they earned in 15 and 16 ordinarily would be credited on July 1st.
Right, but if they're not here July 1st, then how does that get credited?
And that was, if I understand, part of the issue. Right. The way it has been in the past, what's earned this year is credited the first day of the next year to be used during the next year.
But yeah, I guess the point being is if you're going to adjust something to make it, you know, where they accrue it during the year so that it can't use all 3 weeks in the first month and then leave, I guess there is a salary, you can get it back in salary. I don't know what the language is, and which is part of the problem. I guess I don't know what the language is. How you recruit that money if somebody would leave, you know, just say in the beginning of August after they took the whole month of July off.
That was one of the problems with the language. Like, in other words, the thought is it's somewhat interpretational in that the word accrue means on July 1st, that's money owed to me, versus the previous year qualifies me for the PTO that I'm going to be given to use in the following year.
The verbiage actually says upon termination, any and all earned and unused shall be paid out.
Right, but the client, If I were to...
There's no battery in it.
If I were to retire, to be terminated, quit, whatever, on June 30th, would I get next year's vacation paid to me on this check?
You would have earned it during the year ending June 30th, so you would be entitled to it on June 30th.
I don't even want to sleep. So realistically, I guess what I'm asking is if we had somebody that left on, I don't know, they gave it, you know, they left on June 15th, would we pay them next year's vacation?
Pay them what was earned through June 15th, the way that the contract was. They not all did it, but the percentage that they have earned, they would be entitled.
I find that hard to believe that.
That's the burden right now.
Okay.
As I said, I think it's going to be over to some discussion with our legal team to actually go through that clause and see if it. I disagree with the teenage education, but we'll see what.
You disagree with it, in that they don't accrue it the previous year?
I think it's interpreted that the first year of work is you're accruing it, and you get it next year. I would say it's your first year probation. You don't get a vacation the first year, and then second year here is when you get your.
Yeah, and you accrue it during the year. You don't get it all. July 1st. So it's a valid concern. I think that
and
should be clarified.
I think it was just made out that way because that's the way the act that we read, and just to keep it simple, so no one ever questioned it.
I think before we vote on it, we got to make sure that is clearly understood. And so
we got an email.
Yeah.
I can certainly contact our council and express that, but I would think that they would have the ability to revote on that.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's better to get it done right than get it done quick.
Okay. Let me say one other thing about the budget, because I think we've hung our hats on a few issues by saying, well, Mr. Small has X number of dollars in the budget. This budget is a work in progress. Mr. Small had three positions taken out of the budget that we put back in. So there is really nothing in the budget for next year until we vote on it and say, put this in or take it out. So I wouldn't use that as justification for giving anybody a raise.
When we do a five-year budget, I'm assuming we're taking into account salaries and potential increases. So that's the whole essence of a five-year budget. I mean, we kept the teacher's salary flatline for 5 years, although we did change that recently. But that's no way to budget. You can't budget with nothing in there.
And I would agree that just because some things in budget doesn't necessarily mean it's in budget, but I think when you are negotiating, there's generally parameters that you work within, and to me, those numbers that were in the budget are some of the parameters that you're working within. And I know that maybe it's not perfect and it's not everything everybody wanted, but I would, like I said, I agree, you don't necessarily have to give it, but to me, that's the parameters to work within, and that's kind of what we did.
Yeah, I think the concern is sometimes, you know, words are more expensive than money, so just want to make sure that everyone understands.
Oh, no, on the vacation issue, I totally agree. We just didn't have that pointed out to us until
right.
Friday or Thursday or whatever. So.
Any other discussion on that? Okay. Now we move to the final budget development and recommendation. Clearly we know that's not going to be the exact number since we've made some changes made some decisions, and we've had retirements, or are the retirements reflected in here? No. Okay. But the net is $40,000, approximately $80,000 for the two positions to the...
You could call it with benefits, closer to 100.
Okay. So the fund balance would just be $100,000 more, roughly.
Correct. You're currently at...
Well, to make it accurate, for those of us that have the active worksheet up, where would it be appropriate to put $100,000? Would you reduce the...
If you reduce your salaries... I'm in the right column there. I-63, I think that 22,843.
I-63? 22,933?
Currently, 22,943,625. Okay. Well, I guess I'll lead off the discussion. I always felt that it's best to use fund balance first, since that's money we've already taxed. Now the question becomes, what percentage do we feel comfortable as a fund balance, or a dollar figure, however you want to arrive at it, to carry over? Because now we know what our costs are, more or less. You know, we're not exact. We've got it as close as we can. We're going to get it tonight. So really now it's fund balance and what we do with taxes. Unless there's anyone has an idea of what we're going to do, what we're going to reduce or cut to close that gap.
In the last session, I asked about a few numbers in the expenditures. Mr. Small, I don't know if you had a chance to check on those. I'm gonna throw in the 600 level, the supplies. Was it any substantial increase that was due to textbooks?
Correct.
Right, and we had talked about the property at the MEC line and the IT line.
And I had thought I had forwarded an email from Scott Matz.
Scott Matz had explained it was due to some server and some other things in the IT line that needed to be replaced this year. That was his increase.
So that jump from 14-15 of 50,000 up to 118 in 2015-16, and then to 182. That increase of 56,000 was a server expense?
Yes. Trying to reset this thing here.
I
replacement cycle, as well as the server infrastructure. This summer, we're replacing an 8-year-old desktop computer as well as 5 to 6-year-old laptops. Additionally, our main server environment is due for replacement. This is the infrastructure powering email, CSIU user accounts, and these servers are most critical and have higher replacement costs than other equipment in our environment.
Just a general question. So when he's tasked to do that, or he has to do that, like, what's the approval process for those expenditures?
Well, he meets with me, and we go through the timing through, oh, geez, I forget it. I know he works through the IU, and I forget the name of it now. The payment system. I forget how he does it, but it's the CoStars. No, and the IU. So it was a matter of upgrading also for our infrastructure for next year, since our bandwidth isn't broad enough to support what we're doing. So we have a lot of downtime. So with the proposal for the following year of bringing more technology on board, he was tasked with this year for next year, increasing our bandwidth and our capabilities.
So this service is basically contracted, and we're just basically upping our contract of the amount we're spending for that contract?
Well, yes, and also the bandwidth and our capabilities within the district. We're kind of behind other districts, and we're trying to bring in resources and technology that we couldn't do next year. So this is an infrastructure improvement. And we should see the savings coming down later in our textbook costs.
And then the 700 property, the $64,000 for MEC.
I don't have an answer back. I'm sorry. I'll get back in there. I'm sorry.
And then the last one was under 400 purchase property services. The increase to the middle school and the high school, is that the stuff that we worked with Casey on to get estimates for and approve? Is that just the addition of the stuff we've already discussed in previous meetings?
That could include, projects for plant area that are spread throughout the buildings.
I knew we talked a lot about the roofing and the security in the high school.
Right.
So the middle school stands out just to me because
of the
$40,000.
Did we get a breakdown of those final projects? So I know we discussed that.
I said I thought we were doing that this month. I didn't know. But that doesn't mean they didn't put something in the budget.
Yeah. That'd be nice.
Well, the budget had a lot of his 5-year planning in it. Before we talked week to week on our facilities committee, there are a lot of things that he already.
Pretty substantial increase. I mean, like BEC, it goes from 66 to 109,000.
Well, a lot of things were put on hold until after the Thompson study.
Right.
So once the Thompson study ended, it kind of gave the go. It gave the go ahead to put those repairs into action.
I agree.
And the things we talk about during facilities are special projects that he talks about.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And I would like to see what that final list looks like.
Okay.
And getting back to the fund balance discussion, for me, over the years, it's become the most important part is what does it go down to? What is it depleted to at the worst part of the year? I think our worst month is like July, right before the revenue starts coming in. And that's the way I'd like to look at it. How much do we need to budget for now so that when that's at its lowest, it's, 100 or whatever the safest cushion is and built up from there. And frankly, I'm not that concerned about taking that budget down for that, that fund balance down for that brief period of time anymore, knowing that our credit is so strong and other school districts and our district has the option of going out and getting one of those, I forget what they're called, we call them bridge loans. Worst case scenario, we go get a little bit of a loan to help us through that one difficult month. So I want to be aggressive personally with the fund balance.
The only thing I would caution on that is your credit, one of the reasons your credit rating is what your credit rating is because you have a fund balance. When you take that fund balance down, it does affect your credit rating. So just to keep that in the back of your mind.
And these are, the fund balances on the sheet are year ends, right?
Yeah, 5 year.
Yeah, they're only year ends, so. Do you have a what the low mark is on next year?
I have a cash flow sheet that I circulated. I thought we had one.
Yes. Yeah. No, this is one that he had handed out the last month.
Right.
Oh, can we just do that first? Oh, you just got it. Never mind. Sorry.
And Mrs. Knight, keep in mind, you know, we are, the board did vote to go out to reissue some bonds, so
yep.
We don't want to put that into too much jeopardy as far as what the credit would be.
I appreciate that. Thank you.
And then, you know, we also go back to who the heck knows what the state's going to do. So, but you're right, and then you can certainly take a participation loan, but then we're paying interest.
I agree. And the only thing I wanted to add is it seems like every year we budget for the fund balance always ends up higher than what we budget before anyway, because we're good budgeters and we err on the side of caution. So I'm of the mind to be a little more aggressive with it because I know that it's always a little bit higher than what we than our worst case scenario.
Yeah, I mean, I thought misreading, but I thought it was kind of a consensus for a $2 million number. Close to kind of being the number of trying to
change that could be off of that. I agree with Mrs. Spikes. We should be aggressive on the fund balance, and I have a few reasons for that. Well, one is looking at other districts and just seeing what their fund balances is. Some of my balances are rather, but I have a personal philosophical objection to raising taxes for while we're still carrying around millions of dollars that we, my question to the administration on that though would be often, actually it was probably about 3 or 4 years ago, the fund balance was often referred to as the rainy day fund. Are we still, I know it comes up in discussion, if we have a major capital improvement that we need to pay for example, that money would come out of fund balance. Is that fair? I think it's like super.
I'm not familiar with that term.
Discussion. Okay, I remember, do you remember what I'm referring to as the rainy day fund?
I think that's what people called it.
Yeah,
I don't know that it's so much of a rainy day fund anymore. I think it's a reality fund.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So, or at least it was this year.
Well, then the way that I look at it, if we're not going to look at it as a rainy day fund anymore, that amount should be just enough to carry us through the low point. That's my view on it.
I would agree with you, except without knowing all the facilities expenses that we plan on. Like we talked in the last meeting about all the security upgrades, the cameras, we talked about the, I don't know how, that to me is, I mean, when we were in our meeting, facilities meeting, I think we had a total of near $500,000 in expenses, and I know we have that capital set aside, and maybe that covers it. I just think, I'm with you. I don't think we need to carry, $5 million at all times. But I'm saying, I wouldn't want to whittle it down, knowing that we have these other expenses that we feel are pretty critical.
On that, we will always have expenses like that. So I'm putting together a 5-year plan to implement all those things that we're talking about in facilities, safety, security, cameras, like that. So we could roll it out over a 5-year and spread that cost out. We don't have to pay for it. I mean, we sat in facilities, we came up with over $1 million in 30 minutes.
Yeah.
Because, you know, there's lots of things that need to be done. However, we can roll those out over the next 5 years. As long as we stay on task and stay within budget, we can accomplish a lot of things.
Obviously, you have necessities.
Right.
You have upgrades.
Yeah, it doesn't have to be.
Yeah, you can always kick them. Upgrades down
the road. An itemized list, but just do we have an understanding that we have roughly, you know, $500,000 in necessities for next year, and maybe that includes phase one of the roof or phase one of the security and the rekeying and all that stuff, and then, you know, your plan says, say, over the next X number of years, we're going to continue rolling that out, and then we know that, hey, that doesn't exceed the capital that we set aside for those same purposes. I think then everybody can feel a little bit more comfortable about the year-end, fiscal year-end fund balance not being $5 million.
I mean, as
a list, what's going to be performed, obviously, the balance, the capital will be based on that. The high school is a two-part, two-phase for the group. So, be very interesting to see.
I would agree with that, Mr. Possman. I guess maybe part of the confusion is what considering a fund. I mean, I think most of us, or should, if we don't, should have a savings account that I guess you could call rainy day fund or the emergency fund or whatever. I think that's prudent financial. I mean, I don't, rainy day fund to me isn't like, oh, you know, I think we're going to the casino this weekend. It's a lot of brakes running on my car, you know. So I think the school district should have some type of emergency fund as fund balance in addition to what we need to carry over. I don't know what that number is, but if something happens that we need a couple $100,000 to fix something, well, I don't think we should have to go get a loan.
That was the reason I asked my question. I get to hear in my time on the board, like, when we can comfortably spend that rainy day fund. Like, even in the case of the high school, now we're talking about budgeting that in the roof and all these other capital improvements. So under what circumstance would we be comfortable spending that if we're looking at it as a rainy day fund? Would it be if a building collapses? Then would we use it, presumably, but that's what I'm asking.
Well, like the boilers. When the boilers went out in DEC, okay. That's where that money came from.
Yeah. So, $700,000. That's a fundamental difference in philosophy, seriously, that we need to identify on this board. And I appreciate that because of my own personal finances. I do try to keep a rainy day funded. So what we're willing to commit to, though, is like a chunk of money that will never, ever be touched. We'll always be kicked down the road for when the rainy day is because we're not budgeting for a rainy day annually. And that's, I guess, what I'm saying is I fundamentally disagree with that, with the taxpayers' monies. I think that we should be as, you know, efficient with them as we can, knowing that worst case scenario we would have to go out and secure a loan. And it's just a fundamental difference.
So you don't think that we should carry?
Right. I don't think that we should keep, you know, 6 month backup supply if I lose my job so that I can pay my bills for 6 months. And I think that's what you're saying. Now I understand what the discussion on rainy day fund is.
I think
that would always float through the budget.
To an extent, yes, but you also have to remember we can go out and take a loan, but we can't necessarily raise taxes to repay that loan. We can only raise taxes.
I totally agree. I get both ways.
Or whatever index.
I get both ways. I'm just clarifying that is a fundamental difference.
Correct. That would be a financial flaw.
Like a little bit more risk than I'm willing to take than perhaps you want. That's all.
Just a bit of information. When I sent you this breakdown in the morning, since the last budget meeting, you approved the GCA contract, which changed a lot of these numbers around because this 400 area that Mr. Scott is referring to now has all the contract in it.
Yeah.
And we pull things away from other areas. But just so you don't see that come tomorrow and say, where in the world do you come up with those numbers? Because if you look at tonight's presentation, the breakdown was totally changed.
Right. Okay.
Just to further things along, since we don't have a consensus on our fund balance.
I'm sorry?
Since we do not have a consensus on where the fund balance should be.
Now, did I just hear the electronics spreadsheet that you set out on Friday?
Includes
that reflects the GCA.
So that is current?
Right.
Everything is in there?
Right.
All right. I just want to make sure I heard that right.
So just to, you know, if I plug in 29.75 mils, according to my spreadsheet, that leaves us with slightly over $2 million in fund balance, $2,046,000. So down from this year's end of 3.9, projected end of 3.9. So using roughly 1.9 million.
Yeah, current and per Mr. Small's cash flow projection is basically June, July is the low month. So that ending balance is the low. And then it picks back up in August. So the nice thing about that is whatever the end balance target is, that's your low, so that would be your, you'd basically only be at that point for 2 months, roughly.
Right. And so then there's, if you do take down the fund balance even lower, then there's nothing else to offset, because, fund balance right now is offsetting a lot of that features increase. So I know the features are sliding out in a few years, but you take the fund balance even further down, there's no pushing left whatsoever to offset those increases. And again, I'll also point out that there is, we still have a teacher's contract to negotiate. So.
Yeah, I'm just saying, giving perspective, not making a judgment or an opinion.
Okay, still have the basic question of what's the fund balance that we feel comfortable going down to or carrying over?
Well, I mean, whether we agree on the 1.3 or 1.8 or 2, the following year we're looking at negative either way.
Yeah.
So, in my mind, the issue is less about what's going to happen next year as it is 2 years from now.
Right. Yeah, well, we were sorry. If you change the millage of copies of props, I can do it on my phone because I don't have Excel on. That's with no tax increase, right?
Correct.
The forecast for 18-19.
Yeah. I'm just saying, going out now, hopefully there'll be some savings from transportation down the road. We haven't discussed that, but I assume Mr. Small, does the 5-year budget include a reduction in staff at elementary? Does it, if enrollment does continue to drop, or is that going down?
No.
If teachers stay where they're at, even going up in 3 years out in the 2018-19 year, if we're at 31.5 mils, they're still negative. We're now at negative $500,000.
I have reflected no staffing changes in the outgoing years.
So I mean, assuming that there are, I assume there'll be some retirements at least, maybe some replacements, maybe some savings in transportation, maybe some savings in healthcare, et cetera. Reducing the fund balance to less than $2 million. That's the lowest number, really, $2 million. I'd like to see more, but that's a compromise position.
So Mr. Simone, you're saying essentially, whatever teachers we discussed so far, you're booking that straight across. There's no assumption there around student enrollment declining. It's just straight count straight for the reason. Okay.
Is the savings from the refine embedded in your forecast for 17, 18?
Yes, beginning.
How much of the budget, how much did you put in there?
$800,000 for the potential. For the 2007 issue refine. Beginning with the 17-18 year, I show an additional $800,000. That's basically how it was spread. It was $800 over 4 years, around numbers. So that's reflected down under debt service, where you see the savings of $1,135,000 and the following year $901,000. Your bank qualified savings tapered off, but I added $800,000. To your debt savings, your debt service savings. So that is reflected.
In the 900 category there?
Yes.
Okay. And how about the transportation contract? Did you embed some savings in for that?
No, I did not.
And do you have any estimate of how much we could save?
Not until we get these routes done.
So I'm seeing this as like our last kind of hump year. We've got some good things coming next year, and the PISA's levels off. So I personally am willing to be a little, you know, as I say, very aggressive with the fund balance. I don't think it's a reflection at all. I don't think this budget could possibly predict the fund balance for 18-19. It's just, there's just placeholders in there because there's too many moving parts. I don't think we should be looking at the 18-19 negative fund balance to pass this budget because there's too many variables that are not contained, and it's good things that are going to be happening. Not that bad things will happen too, but it's just there's too many moving pieces to raise the taxes this year because the forecast for the 18-19.
Well, no, it's negative in the 17-18.
What's that?
Negative. It's a negative the next year.
It's negative. It's
-900,000.
Significantly negative in 18-19. It's negative $1 million in 17-18, which is the following school year. Now, obviously, we'll know more, you know, a year from now.
Yep. A lot of things are going to come together.
Mrs. Weiss, I know you're coming from a lot of things to come together, but you didn't even go for the lottery five.
That's
kind of in here. So, I'm not saying
you're... Hey, we would have banged 500 if we went with the banks. We would have had to guess.
I'm saying we're hoping to hear it out. That's in here. We're hoping.
Don't make it personal now. It's just business. Okay, are we going to make any decisions?
I mean, what does everybody think? Like, what's everybody's number?
I'm comfortable with a little less than 2 million. Yeah, in the 1.9, mid 1.9s.
I am too.
I don't feel I want to go too much below that.
In the cash flow, what would the low point of the budget be then? Or the fund balance be, Mr. Small, if we started with 1.9? Or is that what you're saying you want the low to be?
You want to end at 1.9?
Is that what you're suggesting?
It's roughly...
You want to end with 1.9?
You would basically be using almost half your fund balance, and your millage would go to 29.45.
What if you went to 1.5?
1.5
million. Because you're there for 2 months.
You're still not looking at the 2 months. I'm looking at...
Well, I'm just saying for next year. You're there for 2 months. Then after that, you're negative for several months once you get beyond the following year. Again, all things being equal, you don't know what's...
So on my spreadsheet, if I put in the 0.45, I get 1.73.
Right.
Is that what?
I was just throwing out the round numbers. The question was, if we went down to 1.15, our fund balance would be 2.71%, and it would be a millage of 29 even.
Yeah, 29
guess that's still.
Yeah, I just think you're taking it all too deep.
It's essentially 29 units, essentially.
Well, I was just answering your question.
Yeah, I mean, I'm just trying to get some perspective,
That's below what I'm comfortable with the fund balance. So, I mean, I know, we're just discussing it, but.
I'm okay with that.
Okay, so your goal for an ending fund balance will be?
1.73.
1.73. If you left it at 29, right? Just hypothetically, right?
I was willing to go down to 1.9.
I was going to say, I'll.
That's as low as I even go.
1.5.
That would be 29.6.
Don't we move?
It wouldn't be 29.6. It would be 29.4.
Maybe I'm using a different spreadsheet here.
Yeah, my numbers are different than his numbers, than Warren's numbers, so I'm not sure.
That's scary.
Now, did you take out the 100,000, reduce the salaries and in the expenditures by 100,000?
Mm-hmm.
So cell 63 becomes 22,843,625.
So it's 29.4.
Yeah, that gives you a 1.918 fund balance, roughly, and change.
Stay number 7 on the list.
No, that's not even a
You get 1918.
If you left that, you count it across.
Okay. Is that what you got me?
I'm sorry?
The ending fund balance is 1,918,763.
That's it. So even with that, in the 2017-18, we go negative $53,000.
What was the index this year?
3.2.
What was it before exception?
2.5. Oh, well, 3.2 allowed an increase of 0.93 mils.
Okay, 0.93.
Right. 0.93. Which would have been 29.89.
Do you have any indication of what the index will be for next
That's
year?
That's what I'm getting at.
Truth be known, what was approved this year for us for the exceptions was special ed. And there's some talk in Harrisburg already, but they already eliminated the PCRS exception, eliminating the special ed exception. It's taught. So to answer your question, I don't know.
But that's the exceptions on top of the 3.2.
Correct.
So do we have any idea what that might be, just the actual straight
index? Let me change two things. What happens if we do money?
That provided 0.75 mils.
Go up to the index next year.
Right, but I'm saying if we raise 0.44 this year, and the theory is, well, or we don't even raise that, because the theory is we can raise it next year. Again, if you can only raise it to the index, whatever the index is, this year that would have given us an additional 970,000. It's not that much when you're talking $56 million. And your PSERS contributions, you know, 8 million or 7 or whatever. I mean, and you're eventually you're gonna have your salaries are gonna go up. Even if it's 1%, I mean, whatever. I mean, costs, electric's gonna go up, things are gonna go up.
Does this work down here?
So I'm just saying we can't put ourselves
well?
Totally behind the goal, we can't raise taxes.
I won't go down below that. I won't go down that. No.
Okay. But in terms of the total expenditures, Like, we're not in the hole in any of these, are we? We're still above.
No, we're negative 550. We deplete all our fund balance in this budget.
But then we build it. Then we build it up the next year to half a million again. So we're working. It would be like a 1 year.
What did you plug in there?
Next year, assuming the index is the same as it is this year, going up to the index next year and the year.
Well, you read.
We don't know what the index is going to be.
Yeah, I'm assuming it's.
Well, we all know Harrisburg does not make any.
Sorry, I'm going to change this map for you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
With that, we would like to move forward with the.
Yes.
Well, again, it comes down to what fund balance do we feel comfortable using up? I'm basically saying half. But, I mean, I don't know if everyone else is, obviously there's going to be a difference of opinion, but I think anything lower than that, then we might be digging ourselves a hole we can't get out of, even with a max tax increase or a referendum. I don't know.
Mike, the fund balance that we're comfortable with, which obviously is a phrase that has been said way too many times here tonight. Is this a one-year only fund balance? Or is this a, because obviously, if we do 29, okay, but my point is this. If we do 29.4 mils now, and that takes us to 1.9 million in the fund balance roughly, right? And we stay at 29.4 next year, we're nowhere near the 1.9. And while there are good things coming, there's not 1.9 million of good things coming. So my point is that to look at, I'm just trying to understand whether the number that's being bandied about, 1.9, is that a one-year number or is that a going forward number? Because if it is, 29.4 is not even close to enough. It's not even close to enough, in my opinion. It's not, let's put it this way. Whether the 1.9 is right, 29.4 is not enough for us to sustain 1.9 million in fund balance in the long term period.
Well, let's say you did it, and then what would you have to raise it the following year to? You couldn't raise it enough.
No,
raise it enough.
Over the index and the exception, right? It's more than you could possibly get to 1.9.
You can't raise it enough.
Right, I mean, and we don't know exactly, but it's. I think we're in agreement that you can't get back to 1.9. Period. So
you couldn't increase taxes given so if one delays today.
Right. So if 1.9 is the number,
you cannot raise taxes high enough to get back to 1.9.
Right. So my point is only that if 1.9 is the number, 29.4 cannot be the number because it does not allow us to get back to 1.9 the following year.
That's correct.
End of story.
I'm going to say again, I think we should have a referendum next year. And you know, at the very minimum, if it doesn't succeed, you get the index. So you got that guaranteed tax increase to the index. And you have the possibility, hey, maybe the voters will decide to raise taxes more. We hear people say that, come to the voting, they say, I'm comfortable with more taxes. Some people say no. Let the people vote. And I hope in the process, more people become familiar with the district's budget. I hope they'll learn. Let them vote. And even if you fail, you still get a tax increase. Put people on the board who want to raise taxes.
I understand that point, but I also understand that we were elected to help set the budget for the school district, and our responsibility according to the school code is to provide an education for the children. There is nothing in the school code that says we have a responsibility to the taxpayer. There's nothing in the school code that says we have a responsibility to the teachers. There's nothing in the school code that says we have a responsibility to the parents. It says our responsibility is to educate the children. And if you do the referendum where you kick the tax hike down your road, you're no different than the state government that you guys all sat here 3 months ago crucifying because they were kicking the can down the road. All you're doing is kicking it down to the taxpayers. If they kicked it to us, you're going to kick it to them.
Well, the difference is the taxpayer never was paying.
I understand that, but your job is to provide an education.
I understand that, Ms. Bergowski, but also the state code allows for the referendum. It's not like we're not doing our jobs by following the law. I mean, those are opportunities.
Right, but you're going to put the district in a position where the only way it can survive is with the taxpayers voting for a referendum.
Well, no. The district will be decided. No. The people who make up this district will determine the district's future.
And the people that make up this district voted 9 people in, and they want because they're responsible. So we can put it to a vote, and if 5 people vote to put it to a referendum, then we don't raise taxes. If 5 people vote to raise taxes, then we raise taxes.
I mean, you can raise taxes this year, next year, and do the referendum.
You
there's a thought there. I mean, I'm not advocating that, absolutely.
Just for discussion, Mr. Kurtz gave me the index number. Even if we did an index tax increase next year.
Index for this year.
I'm sorry?
That was the index for this year.
Well,
it could be different next year.
Yeah, it could be different. We're just throwing out something. That leaves us with $886,000 of fund balance the following year. We're even with another index tax increase, we're still $1.3 million underwater.
Right, and I just crunched numbers using the spreadsheet to get us to the 1.9, assuming that that's the fund balance number. It's almost 31.3 mil, which, as we already discussed,
does that include the compound from year over year?
I don't know, because I don't know what they're more into.
Because you got to include the half of your admin this year. Right,
probably not, Jeff. But it's close enough, right? Yeah. I mean,
you have 31.3?
Yeah, I have 31.28.
And the max before this year would have been 30.64.
Right, so I'm not saying 1.9 either isn't the right number. I'm simply saying at 29.4 it's not sustainable. So we either need to agree on the fact that that fund balance number has to be lower, or the tax number the millage number has to be higher, or else we're deceiving ourselves.
I'll second you.
We want to do it, see if it passes.
I'd go back.
Originally, over a month ago, I said 3/4 of a mil was probably where we were ready. So I go back to 3/4 of a mil.
I would second that 3/4 of a mil.
What's the mill? What's the millage number you're talking about?
If I excluded the 0.04, so it would be 29.71.
Just so we're all using the same numbers, is that what I heard you say?
Let's do 29.7. How's that? All right, nice round number.
Do you, my calculations say a 29.7 for 2 years, possibly absent compounding.
Right.
We're at like 575 fund balance in 2 years at 29.7.
Yeah.
Do you guys agree with that? Is that what you're getting as well? Just so that we all are on the same page.
Okay. I've been quiet through this whole discussion, and I will say this quietly and briefly. The biggest increase that we face is salary and benefits this year, next year, and the following year. The only control this board has over PISRs is to control the number of employees and the amount of salary we pay. And what I've heard here tonight is we're reluctant to control the number of employees, and we're not willing to hold the line on salaries and just give bonuses. We're still going after 3% increases plus longevity increases.
Any more discussion? So the motion.
Just to be clear, sorry, is this a motion for a final budget with that number, or is this just to get the table where the board is?
No, this is a straw poll. I have a number for the vote for next week. I mean, it's up to vote.
Yeah.
I'd need it.
So it leaves us basically 2.2 million in fund balance for next year.
Okay.
Right, 2.2 million for next year, and if we were to assume that we liked 1.9 this year for whatever reason, and then we were comfortable with 1.5 the following year, which there seemed to be some consensus that, or some people clearly weren't comfortable with 1.5 this year, but if for whatever reason we were comfortable with 1.5 next year, all other things equal, that being said, you know, the budget being materially correct, we need to go to 30.6 the following year just to get to 1.5. So while I understand that Mr. Rathgeb came up with a number that he was hoping maybe people would vote for, I question the merit of going to 29.7 if we are in agreement that we need to be at 30.6 or higher in subsequent years to get us to a fund balance with which we're comfortable. That's all.
Money
fairy flies over to the district next year and drops a couple million. Okay, well, how we want to vote on it, get an idea. So just roll call?
Yes.
Okay.
What are we voting?
We're voting the motion. The
we're
motion.
Voting to see if we have, the board has a stomach to raise taxes.
The motion right now is.
Is that what we're saying?
The motion right now is to move to 29.7 for the
which would give us 2.2 next year, but it's a half a million
so
year after.
The TA that's out there that was approved for the 94 non-teacher folks. If you took that, if you kept them flat and cool. Said you get nothing more than what you got, it saves us over 3 years $168,000.
I don't know how you can really.
I'm just saying, like, so
know,
that's
take
yeah,
that.
Call it $50,000 a year. That's going to save you how many mills is that?
Nothing.
3 mills.
Point
3 mills.
Yeah,
0.5. I'm just asking.
A mill's
100,000 is a little more.
Sorry.
Mr. Scott, 100,000 is a little more than a tenth of a mill. So 180,000 would be 2/10 of a mill.
Over 3 years.
Right. That's the board's frivolous handing out of raises. I'm a little stuck on it. Sorry. I mean,
well, I think we still.
It's unrealistic to think that.
Getting back to that.
That everyone that works in this district is going to stay flat for 3 years. It's just unrealistic. I'm not going to publicly debate whether or not someone deserves or doesn't deserve the money, but I will say that it's unrealistic to think that any workforce is going to go so long without a raise. That's my personal opinion.
Also, just as another interesting data point, if we were to go to 30 this year, just I think arbitrarily 30 because it's very round, right? 30, 2.5 million fund balance next year. If we stayed at 30, it goes 2.5 next year, 1.2 the following year, and negative 2 million. The year after that.
Well, I mean, I would venture to guess that by then we'll have some more.
I'm not disputing it, but once again, I'm not talking about being 200,000 in the hole.
No,
I'm talking about being 2 million in the hole. That's
you.
All. So.
Oh, we've had that like the 3-4 years in a row. We just cut stuff. Can we get Rick and Vern all together?
I'm getting warmer. Fans are optional.
Okay, we still have a motion.
Well, we can see where it goes. If it fails, we can propose a higher one or a lower one.
Still,
are we how
okay.
Call? It's secretary, or should we just go around, or what?
Can we just be clear for everyone in the room that this isn't a
final decision.
Right.
Draw a vote.
Get a sense of the room kind of thing for everybody here.
What do we know?
I don't.
Just do something.
Well, yeah. Right now, the motion is 29.7.
Vote show of hands.
Show of hands of support for it.
Five, four in favor? Is that what other people thought? Yeah.
That's what you're going to get. Would you begrudgingly approve that if that was all you had?
If that's the best we're going to get, yes, I will accept that.
Would you like to propose 30 and see if you get five shows of hands?
In the spirit of progression here, for those who vote no, convince me that I should vote no. What are our alternatives?
Besides referendum, we already...
The teacher's contract is still in limbo, so we don't have any answers there. We can't really make any decisions on that. So we have to leave those numbers where they are.
It's just arguing that we can take the fund balance down lower in my mind. We need to carry 2.2 over.
But even with that number, it goes negative when? Two years out?
I'm only looking at this year. There's too many variables for next year. I refuse to look out 4 years in this budgeting.
But it does go negative 2 years at the level.
I heard you. And I think we have a lot of options to address the next year. One other question, too. The basic education funding formula that was approved, the new formula, what do you expect for that for Boone? About the same?
That's only new money.
That's right.
The old money stays.
No, that'll affect the subsequent year's budget.
And I think as far as new money goes, we're actually on the losing side of that.
We are on the losing side. I know you said that at one point.
It's all harmless for the existing money. Any money that the governor and legislature approve, in addition, new money, as was said for next year, is dependent on the new funding formula, which is based on poverty levels and enrollment, etc. So
we can't lose, but we probably won't gain.
We wouldn't get much out of the additional money.
Okay. We'll gain, but there's not going to be a huge windfall coming our
okay,
way.
Okay, I just want to double check.
We're not chucking up and
we haven't sold the trucks yet.
Well, I have a question though too, and I'm not necessarily directing this to you, but I'm going off of something I said, right? So, kind of what I hear is we're worried about, let's worry about this year and not look out. But one of the things that's been repeatedly said over the last 6 years is that when we did the stadium, when we did the teacher's contract in 2013, when we did all these things, we didn't look at the year after year after year effects. We just looked at the year that it was done. Well, if you're going to look at the effect of that, then you also have to look at the effect of taxes. I mean, you can't look at one thing in a vacuum and one thing as the cause and effect. So, I don't know that we can beat up other people for not looking at the long-term effects if we're not looking at long-term effects.
I appreciate the way you want to look at it. I just see too many moving pieces. And I see what I need to see in next year's budget, then I think we're going to be okay. But it's done.
It's not done. If you look at that, it's done. But we still have a week to a vote, and we're trying to work through things. So I guess what you're saying is you guys aren't changing your mind, and we're not going to change our mind, so you're done. What Jeff's trying to say is, what factors should I consider?
It's just a different philosophy. I think it's okay to run that budget down.
The salaries aside, we can... it's not going to change anything. I mean, we're negative if we stay flat with taxes.
I think Ms. Parnassi had an excellent point.
In a year.
You're screaming for years to get a five-year budget. Mr. Mays will finally get one out of the business office, and now we don't use it. So it doesn't seem to make sense to me.
I think I am using it. I'm interpreting it differently than you are.
No, I think there is an issue here. Mrs. Blythe, I would say, is using the budget.
Absolutely.
And then the assumption that everything remains the same, that's where I find fault with it, because I know they're not. The one thing we know about next year is that everything will not remain the same. between the RFPs we're putting outside. I mean, that's fine. It's just clear that some of us aren't using the five-year model.
Let's assume the teacher's contract, right? Let's assume that there's no increase. At some point, you have to relent and give steps. That's an increase every year. It's a big increase. So all things being equal is probably underestimating our cost.
Yeah.
And that's why I feel like we're being a little short-sighted.
Well, it's also not taking into account any potential staff reductions. We have the bubble that continues to move throughout the district, and at some point in the future is going to hit the middle school and the high school. And those are substantial changes in class enrollment. You're going from classes of 300-some students down to classes of 200-some.
Yeah, but we've had double-digit reductions in staffing, and yet our
mainly
cost
that was at the
up.
Elementary level. Correct? That was at the elementary level for the most part. It's going to come to the secondary level in a few years. That's just another thing to consider.
I'm not saying you're wrong. I'm just saying, like, consider that all things being equal, could be underestimating.
If you're looking at the conditions and the subtractions, it might actually net out.
But do we really think that between the savings we're going to see potentially from the RFP, between the refinance we did, between however long the status quo? Okay, sure. Between we have things, though, that I don't know. I'm saying I think we're going to save money still in future years, and we're not going to.
I hope you're right, though. I hope we can maintain.
You know, if we're wrong, we could reduce taxes.
For what was that?
If you're right, we could reduce taxes or stay flat.
Are you removing that?
No. I'm saying. You're worried about year one, right? Well, what if we're wrong? What if you're wrong? And then we can't raise taxes high enough. But if you're right, we can always reduce them.
Yeah, I'm not going to convince the board of this, but there's a safety valve, and that is a referendum.
And I'm not going to convince you guys of that, but again, that's my hill.
Mr. Rathke also invoked the name of Mr. Basil, who, when he talked about a five-year plan, included closing the building, which, if the numbers I saw are correct, saves more than $500,000 a year. Between that and teacher reductions based on declining enrollment, that's considerable.
Do you really want to go with the building closing again? I thought we could discuss that. We're not closing,
even if you get to year three and it makes sense, from the enrollment perspective, yeah. The money aside isn't going to make up the difference. It just isn't. So.
Yeah, well, it seems like there's a definitive split on the board, and there obviously. You know what I'm saying? The majority, it seems like the majority wants to increase taxes. Question is, what number is the majority comfortable with?
Could we take a second vote at 30 mils, just once again, to see how that changes the voting result, if at all?
There's a second.
I know, I'm out.
I can second it, and we can vote, but I don't think
so. You don't need a second for a straw vote?
I don't think so either, but I'm just saying, because Connor said so, a show of hands, I would go to 30.
It's.
I'd have to sleep on that one.
It's too much. It's too much for a bite.
Yeah.
All right. So, what we agreed on is 29.7.
So that would be the number that goes into the next version of the budget.
Yep.
Well, we still have that language to clean up in the support staff, in that. Depending on what you know, if they're agreeable, you know, that may not be included in here.
And this, the straw vote, did we do a straw vote for the TA?
We got information late. What the servers were down on Wednesday?
Yes.
Okay, because we couldn't get any information on what transpired until Mr. Fitzgerald sent out the update.
Yeah.
And that language was news to me, as Mr. Martino pointed out. So, I mean, it's just interpretation, and I think it just needs to be addressed.
Well, that aside,
clarified.
I don't know how much that's going to change the finances, but
it's not.
At all.
I was going to suggest that regardless of whether we approve that or not, Mr. Spall needs to put that money into the budget.
Yeah, I think it should go into the budget for budgetary purposes, because what we're talking about really isn't doesn't impact the money side.
But do we want to do a show of hands on the current TA, assuming that we're going to address the language? Because if honestly, I think if the majority feels no on it, then we would want to know that sooner than later so that we can go back and...
Would it be any, instead of, I mean, there's no harm in doing it, Mr. Awful, I think it might, we just pass our version of the agreement, it becomes tentative on their end then, if they accept ours, like we change the language to what we want it to reflect, and then we pass that, and then they just have to vote.
No, they have to do it first.
They have to go first.
Oh, okay.
So they may have to redo it again.
Right.
And as I understand, it doesn't affect everybody. Is that what I heard you say? Is that true? Is there a reason why it doesn't affect everybody if it's in the contract?
The vacation piece?
Yeah.
I think that affects everybody.
Okay. Well, then maybe I misunderstood.
The additional vacation was affecting.
But that aside, right. The vacation aside, just the raises, the financial part of it. Mr. Martino.
I don't feel comfortable weighing in on it until I see the complete package. And without that vacation piece tied down.
And since that is negotiation, I want the solicitor's not here, so it's not worth asking, but is it an executive session topic?
That's what I said, we should just wait until we get the complete package before we can discuss it. Public comment? Anybody?
Hurry up. Once we make a motion to adjourn, we're out.
216 Colorado Drive, Birdsboro. I think a minimum rainy day fund of $1.9 million is way too large. It's the minimum $1.9 million. But I am right that if we pick a number of a million, we should keep it flat throughout however long the plan is. That makes sense to me. There's a five-year plan on the website. Is that the same one you're working off of? Because it's half over. Is there a newer five-year plan that we should be seeing?
I haven't posted what the worksheet we're working with.
And it goes into 1920? Is that... I'll
see what's up there. It probably should be pulled down, and then once the budget's adopted, then we'll put up...
Okay, but I mean, in the one that you're looking at, year number one is the year that just ended?
No, it's 14-15, I believe.
Okay, so my suggestion would be let's have a five-year rolling plan that actually looks 5 years in the future, and let's actually bake in everything that we think that should be in there so that we don't actually have a plan that nobody thinks is accurate. So if we think we're going to close buildings and we think we're going to reduce staff, that should be in the plan. If we think we're going to raise teacher salaries, I think that should be in the plan. I think the plan should be as accurate as possible so that you guys can make the best choices possible. I think... If you look at the current five-year plan, it's on the website, as a taxpayer, you're looking like, well, the number of students keep going down, the taxes keep going up, and the five-year plan ends with the taxes still going up. So you can't really tell, say, oh, well, maybe we'll get to, and I don't want anybody to panic because I'm making these numbers up, you know, we're going to get to 32, and then we'll actually be able to keep it flat. But right now, it looks like it just goes up forever, and the number of students keep going down. And I believe there's a correlation between that. I think as you're driving the taxes up, you're chasing away new families, and you're going to have fewer and fewer kids in school. Lastly, did I hear you were replacing email servers?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay, you're crazy. Big companies provide services. You know, you can pay by the drink. There's no reason that the school district has an email service at all. Big companies like Microsoft and Google do it very well, fairly inexpensively.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, David Shriver, 280 Colorado Drive in Union Township. I think like he was just saying, the problem is the taxes are already too high, and that's what's driving this 100 students a year decrease. That's what the evidence is. And the problem is, as the gentleman in the corner said, Mr. Martino, is the high cost of the teachers, but also the administrators as well, so that their salaries, I think, also should be looked at. I've not heard anyone talk about that. But that's what you can control. Increasing the millage doesn't solve the problem, and we've already seen that over the past 10 years. Just continuing to increase it where it's already a 40% increase, and we still have a problem. It can't just continue like that. You have to look at reducing the number of teachers and possible administrators. That arbitrary amount of teacher or student limit for class of 24 is just that, arbitrary. There's a study I've looked at them that says there is not a correlation when you're in the number of students of 20 per class, that that's going to have much of an effect. If the parents aren't going to take the responsibility to push their kids, we can't control that by trying to reduce class sizes to the point where we can't afford it. My kids are in Catholic school, I mentioned that last time, and there's 29 students in the class, and they're doing really well because the parents are on them. And if you have a good teacher in place, according to these studies, and you have parents that care, it's going to make a difference. But you can't stop at that 24, because at this point, we can't afford that arbitrary limit. And I understand, you know, you're coming to us saying that there's a crisis, but you don't have a good enough reason to raise the taxes to this point when you haven't addressed the problem, which is you can't afford the teachers and the administrators that you have. You have to look at that. And, you know, we're dealt the hand that we have with the pensions from the state, but you can control that number, and that's what you have to look at. And nobody wants to have to cut teachers or employees, but when you have a business, you have to do that. If you can't make the payroll, you can't keep the number of employees that you have. So I'm just asking and hoping that the board will look at that, and I know it's a hard decision, but you're going to have to get to that point where you get to it this year or another year, but the millage is not sustainable. We can't afford it, and it's causing a problem where the enrollment's going down, the property's going down, it's causing a chilling effect, and we can't do it. Thank you.
Well, just one thing, just from a historical sense, the reduction has been the students coming into our first grade, they're just not being born. It's not that they're moving out of the district. We do get people move in, move out, but primarily over the last, from 2012, we've seen a steady decrease. And it's people's reaction to the economy. You know, if you're out of work, you're not going to start a family, you're not going to expand your family. And what we're seeing that result. And, you know, Mr. Small, when I look at the retirement subsidy, that's what we're reimbursed for the PEASERs from the state?
Yes.
So back in 2011-12, the retirement cost the district a little less than $2 million. This year alone, in our budget, it's $7 million.
Right.
I mean, it's easy to just to say, well, it is what you get from the state is what you get from the state. But when you hear the word pension crisis, they didn't do anything in the state, so this is where, you know, the rubber meets the road. We have to make the hard decisions to raise somebody's taxes because they don't want to do that to be popular, okay? But we have to be responsible, and, you know, yeah, we'd like to be popular, but, you know, I'll show you a board that's never made a tough decision that they were the ones that are popular. That's just the way it is. And, you know, I wasn't comfortable with really this tax increase. But at the end of the day, we need to provide an education for the students. We've been, you know, for the last 4 years, we haven't had any tax increase at all, yet these costs have continued to rise. And during that time, the board has been very creative in trying to manage costs, to, you know, right-size the district, okay? And I think there's an argument that can be made that maybe at one time we maybe over-right-sized the district, and we've driven up the class size is too high, and I think we've had that debate here over the last couple of weeks, and, you know, we try to want to get to that what we're comfortable with. All those things, anything in education has a cost, and we're only getting so much from the state. We're getting increased costs, and you know, we refinance the bond. You know, if I wouldn't feel comfortable raising someone's taxes if we didn't do a lot of things that this board did to try to mitigate what the tax increase would be, you know, whether it's
you know, looking at different ways, squeezing more blood out of the stone, from asking the administration to cut back in the building level, to refinancing our bonds, which contribute a lot of money to the budgets over the next couple of years. But after, at the end of the day, you have to open the doors and you have to provide the students with a good quality education.
I agree. The one thing I didn't hear, though, was the number of teachers going down.
It's gone down. We've furloughed teachers for the last 7 years, at least.
Please, no comments from the back, please.
But that's, I think you have to keep looking at it, because the mills, you just can't keep up.
I agree.
Thank you.
Laurel Reno, 367 Buckhead. I just have a question about capital fund. We have spent many, many years using duct tape and chewing gum to fix things in our buildings. Last year we had the boilers done at BEC, and it was an unexpected hundreds of thousands of dollars, I believe, to repair that. I've been in the high school for events. Not every sink works in the women's bathroom. Listening to my daughter, bathroom doors don't lock. The stall doors don't close. Ceilings leak. I understand that might be the roof. But I want to know, yesterday I think there was mention that the five-year plan maintenance thing. Do we have something so that we're very lucky? We have a lot of new buildings that don't require maintenance. But we have a couple old buildings. And I, for one, am kind of embarrassed at the shape that our high school is in. And I'm hoping that there's going to be some major work in it this summer. However, given the state of our classified staff with maintenance and grounds crew, is that going to be feasibly possible? Will we have big enough crew to take care of these issues?
Mr. Harris would probably comment on that, but we have set aside $500,000 in this budget for everything you just said.
Okay.
The kids at the high school are not like the elementary schools; they tear the place up.
Absolutely.
And you know that it's sometimes not feasible to shut a bathroom down and replace every part that they knocked out. We've seen some of those pictures float around in the public. A lot of them are inaccurate. Most of them are accurate, as far as the conditions of, you know, broken doors, this type of thing. We're hoping to address that, and Mr. Harris will, I'm sure, comment.
Right.
On that.
This summer, the restrooms are going to get a major overhaul. And I spoke with the students and was in the restrooms. We shut them down halfway through the year because of it. Lack of sinks, mirrors, holes in doors. I've seen them live. Okay, so it won't be the same way when you come back.
They don't necessarily take care of what they have. 100% get that. I don't want my taxes raised. I understand that they need to be raised. And I'm so thankful that you're this year using fund balance, some furloughs and cuts, and the taxes. Because for 5 years of not raising taxes, we've dug a hole. Thank you.
Any other public comment?
I really don't know where to go with it, other than to simply say,
as a taxpayer and representing people who aren't here, and God knows there are legions of them that should be here expressing the same things, it's unsustainable. Depending on where you live in the district, you're probably not going to feel the fight where, as other places in the district, you're going to feel a real kick. It's unsustainable. It can't keep on going. It's the perfect storm, and ultimately, it's going to affect the social and economic health of the community. I thank you for considerations that you're making. I know they're tough decisions, and you know, Lord knows, you're stuck with a real crisis in terms of this pension bubble. How the heck that ever happened? I think all of us shake our heads and say, you know, why? But nonetheless, you know, you're the folks who are dealing with it, and I appreciate the wrestling with the problem. Do whatever you can to keep them down. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Poore.
Can I just comment? One of the things that's really unsustainable and has to change is the amount of commercial revenue we get from this district.
Yes.
And so I hope that there's this much passion and rigor when the township holds their meetings, because you look across this county, which is fairly rural, if you take Reading out of the picture, and the average percentage of their revenue for commercial is 14%. Anyone have a guess as what Booth is? Anyone not on the board have a guess?
About 5.
Yeah, it's 6%. So about 40% of what the average is. So you know, we can talk about class size and we can talk about teacher reductions. The fact is that you drive from Wawa to, I don't know, where does it end? The Keystone Mobile Home area. From there to there, there's nothing enticing anybody to move here. And the revenue just isn't there.
Can I ask you more quick questions?
Absolutely.
First of all, where does EIT come in? The Earned Income Tax. You have no control over Earned Income Tax.
Correct.
It's local revenue, are you?
No, it's a half, I mean, we can only do a half a percent, that's it. That's set by the state.
But if you don't work in the county, you don't get anything.
All right, is there I'm sorry? You really should approach the microphone so you can go in the record.
I'm sorry. I just have 5 things I've kind of been tossing around. One of them was actually brought up by Mr. Harris, possibility of making money with the new transportation negotiation. Sorry.
No problem, it's my fault.
I'll pause that way. I just didn't steal extra time. Sorry about possibly doing a pay-to-go for students for after-school transportation route to be able to put some money into the transportation fund to be able to try and get income, because that was kind of a talk for some of the side groups that we've had. Also, again, I bring up the idea of following those students who have left the district. I appreciate, again, the mention, you know, students that are not in our buildings. Thank you for bringing that up. Students in Catholic school, the students who are not here, just like running a business, why aren't they here? Why aren't we picking up the phone again? I'll do that in my summer along with my side jobs that I do to supplement my income from the district, because I don't make $80 billion an hour. You can look at what we make. Also, the incentive plan to try and get the top tier teachers out. We know what happens when a teacher that's been here 30 years leaves. There's money because you don't rehire at the sometimes, you know, very large figure that they're leaving at. And then a really weird question, I don't know anything about it, a disclaimer, yes, I am an aide in the district. The contract thing that's going through for aides, secretaries, and IT has aides in there with secretaries and IT. Secretaries are hired like 180, sorry to say like 180, 200, 240. IT are year round. Aides are 183 or 187. 183, 187, 200 don't need vacation. They're getting 165 plus days of vacation built in. Could a stipulation, and I don't know.
Full time.
But even full-time, we're on like a day schedule, 187 days.
It doesn't affect it. It only affects like the 260 and the 264 employees.
Okay, so the number for vacations that was being referenced, I think it was on this side of the table, isn't being allotted to that appropriation, because that changes the appropriation of the money in that, because obviously there's no need for vacation and all of that in that.
Okay. And it was only a year for folks who were 15 years or more getting the third week. That was the act.
And for full-time, right.
And I know nothing about it, like, I don't care, I haven't been raised in the 3 years I've been here, so I know nothing and don't care, but I just, in terms of money, in terms of looking at budget and income, so. Okay, I just bring those things up, so maybe, you know, there's income possibility, maybe, but I know you're tired, so thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Lee. Any other public comment?
I go to the township meeting all the time, and I brought up there this per capita tax in the valley. I don't know how many people rent in this district, but I brought up the township meeting. They have an ordinance that landlords are supposed to report to them their tenants who live where after 30 days. They want to abolish that ordinance because they said it's unenforceable. That's school district money. And one of the board members or supervisors said that he doesn't like the idea because he's a landlord. But I know $15 isn't much, but why did they implement it in the first place? You know, that helps the school district. So it appears the township and the school board are working. $15 every little bit helps. And as far as that, getting the time in for your vacation, when I, before I retired, I had to have work almost through September to get my time in for my vacation for the following. And that's without missing any time. So remember how many days that was. September, so I just a thought. And I wish I could get a 2% raise in my retirement.
Thank you. Is there any other public comment?
Motion to adjourn.
Second. We're adjourned.